Okay, let's get started. So, right, so I hung out with a fun crowd yesterday night who introduced me to the concept of the volcano. Several follow-ups. So, I don't know, somehow this morning I woke up with a strong feeling that the words physics, horror, absinthe, sensual, Genghis can impregnate, defenestrate, manlier and mansier and bro have something to do with the landscape, but I couldn't quite figure out what. Strong feeling, it's like something deep to it, so I stare at it, connecting the dots, you know. Maybe it will come back to me later in the talk, but if you have any ideas, let me know. Okay, so let's see if we can survive this. Right, so last time I got into sort of the hardcore details of, you know, how you can actually count vacua, compute distributions of them over the moduli space, right? We obtained that, despite the fact that obviously constructing these vacua is extremely difficult explicitly, nevertheless got a very nice result that enlarged the zero range charge limit. They're distributed proportionally to the Euler density in the moduli space, and right, so the density of vacua or classical ground states given by zero range charge Q naught, and well, for simplicity, it's essential in the case of the two range charge zero. This was given by pi Q naught K power over K factorial, where K is -3/2, which is basically p³/2 in the large p limit. Okay, and this is valid in the q naught larger than p approximation. That's definitely valid there. Okay. You can see that it's not going to be valid in when q naught is smaller than p, or even when q naught is smaller than p³, because you know. In that case, in fact, this estimate will give you something that's exponentially small rather than exponentially large. Okay. But so it's this kind of computation that is responsible for this famous number, 10^500, and, which is a huge number, but nevertheless, for applications to black hole entropy counting, you know, microscopic computation of black hole entropy, this is still not enough, and you can see this from the fact, well, if you know the formulas for black hole entropy, which you probably don't, let me give them to you, goes something like proportional to Q naught p³ in the large Q naught limit, right? So the number of black hole microstates should grow like the exponential of that, which is still a much faster growth than this thing. Okay. The reason why this is still so far off is because we haven't looked at the most general bound state of the given charge. And of course, we're looking at B40 black holes, but of course, we should be counting all possible states, quantum states, if you want, which have that charge. And the one thing we have been ignoring so far is the fact that you can bind point-like D0 rings to the D4 ring. So this is a D4 ring. We have various fluxes through cycles, and that certainly have that degeneracy. It's already significant. But it's also possible point-like D0 brains stuck to the D4, they can move around, they're unobstructed once they're on the D4 brain. So, you know, in principle, you have to quantize them and count the number of supersymmetric ground states. Okay. rings, they can form bound states among themselves, okay, marginal bound states among themselves, meaning that these little dots can have like arbitrary zero brain charges, and each bound state of n zero brain charges, zero brains with themselves, you know, has the same degeneracy than a single zero brain. So one way of seeing this is just from M theory. So what is a zero brain in type 2A? The zero brain in type 2A is just a KK mode in M theory. Right? Now you can have a KK mode of like a single harmonic, you can have a double harmonic, a triple harmonic going around the circle. All of these things have the same degeneracy as seen from a 10-dimensional theory, but you have to take all of them into account. Okay. Very good. So that's the counting problem we face. Now, fortunately, in supersymmetric quantum mechanics, the ground states are very simple, and so there is a well-known, famous correspondence between supersymmetric ground states and harmonic differential forms. It's very simple. The Hamiltonian is a Laplacian acting on forms on that surface. The supercharges are given, the supersymmetry generators are just given by the exterior differential d and its emission conjugate. And the fermion number in particular. In the case at hand, in fact, you can show that there are no non-trivial one cycles on this four cycle, reconsidering, or non-trivial one or three forms. So all you have is these even forms, which means that all states are in fact bosonic, which also means that the number of one particle states and also the number of n particle states will in fact be equal to the Witten index, which means that the computation of the number of states is completely robust. Like, you know, the fact that we're making approximations along the state shouldn't matter. The counting result we get should be exact. Okay, and so this number B2 that we have here is the same number B2 that we have seen before here. So we already know what it is. All right, so now, how do you compute multiparticle states? Again, it's easy thanks to the fact that we have supersymmetry. We can think of these particles as non-interacting particles. And so we can just construct a Hilbert space as a Fock space. Okay. So the multiparticle, the multi-D0 Hilbert space space. build it just from creation operators, a dagger with indices given by the D0 brain charge number and an index labeling the one particle state. Okay, so M1, 2, 3, that's the zero charge of the particle. And R is the one particle state. Okay, so this goes from 1 to B2 plus 2 is labels the one particle state. Yeah. Okay. Very good. Now how do you count, you know, the number of states with a given zero charge? Well, you can make the following simple observation. So how can you generate like all possible combinations of creation operators, right, which will give you all states? And all this is easy. You just follow. Okay. So first, for one particular the zero charge and the state, you can look at one particle states, two particle states, particle states, all with the same quantum numbers, right? And so these are all bosons, right? And just and so on for one set of quantum numbers. And now, if you want all possible states, what you do is just take the product over all M and R of all these combinations, and then in this product you will get all combinations of creation operators corresponding to all possible states. Okay. So now, to keep track of the charge, we're going to do the following. We're just going to multiply this by e to the minus y naught times the charge associated to each of these operators, which is m. And here, e to the minus 2y naught m, e to the minus 3y naught m, and so on. Right, so now what we get now is a product, all these combinations of operators, and basically the coefficient at each power of e to the y naught will give you all possible combinations of creation operators of that given charge. But of course, we're not really interested in getting all these combinations. We're just interested in the number, in the total number. Right? So to do that, you just replace all these operators by one. Okay. Just one, because then indeed, multiplying these various powers of e to the minus y naught, you will get exactly the number of n particle states with that particular charge. Okay, so this product over here is the same as the number of the number dn of states with D0 brain charge n. So what is this thing? Well, first of all, this infinite sum, you can just sum up. Like this. Yeah. See is trivial because R just isn't clear here. So what this is just the product over M, 1 minus y naught M to the power R. Yeah. And as you might recognize, this is essentially the eta function, which which also appears at various points when you quantize strings. That's not a coincidence, because the dual way of getting the system is from wrapping an M, like, you know, in M theory, wrapping an M5 ring around the theory circle, reducing from the surface sigma 4, getting an effective string, quantizing that, and you get the same kind of generating function in that case, just counting string modes, mapping the string modes going around the circle. Okay. Very good. So, well, this means we are done. Right? We can now write down the full generating function, getting all contributions, like this point, like the zero brain charges and flux combinations. Okay, so the full generating function z y naught and y two is given by the one we already had. This one over y naught to the b over two e to the minus y two squared y naught times. So these are contributions from fluxes, plus critical points of the superpotential. These are contributions from the zeros. And actually, there is an overall shift of the zero brain charge, which is induced by the curvature of the D4 brain. Okay, I haven't mentioned this yet, but in the coupling of the D brain to the Ramanujan Lagrange fields, there is a term proportional to the Euler characteristic of the forebrain, again, coupling to the Ramanujan 1 form. So that means that you just get a shift of the D0 brain charge given by this. This is not important for the actual counting, so you get a induced D0 brain charge, which is given by the Euler characteristic of the D4 divided by 24, is this number. It's not a problem for the counting, but it makes actually the generating function prettier, because this is exactly what you need to complete this product here in exactly the eta function. Okay, so this means that this thing is exactly the eta function. This should be R. No, this should be B plus 2. Yeah. Okay, so this is eta to the B plus 2. Minus B. Again, it's not essential for the counting, but it's nice that it comes out that way. Which means that this thing is a modular form. It has nice modular transformation properties, which you can just look up on Wikipedia or something, so you don't actually have to do any computation anymore to extract now the large n asymptotics of this thing. Okay. But you could, if you want, just do the usual saddle point method to extract this.
Is there some way you could have guessed that from knowing that modular transformation property had?
Yeah, so that's right. You can. So what we've written down here is, well, it's just a formal generating function, but if you remember the Euclidean action and so on that came out of, just string theory, it was exactly of this form. So basically this, what this thing is really the D4D0 partition function, where these Ys get identified with the Ramon-Ramon background fields, basically. And you know that the D4D0 partition function must have certain modularity properties, because you can, so if you think about a Euclidean D4D0 partition function, right, wrapping around periodic Euclidean time, you can dedualize along the time direction. It's Euclidean, you go to type 2b, you get like d3, d minus 1, bound state, so you get a d3 partition function. which transforms to itself under S-duality.
Yeah.
Then you go back to A. So you derive that this partition function should be invariant under S-duality. And when you look what that is, you see that's exactly the requirement that this thing is a modular form. So you could have guessed it that way. Yeah. It has to be consistency of strict theory. Okay. Very good. Okay, so you can apply a modular transformation to this, and why would you do such a thing? So to get we're interested now in extracting the large and the larger zero range charge asymptotics, and to do that, you have to, in principle, integrate this partition function, right? Like the inverse transformation, do a saddle point approximation, where the saddle point will lie at a small value of y naught, right? So the large n and the small y naught regimes are related to each other. So that's what we're going to get at. So therefore, we like to do a modular transformation. Because then this thing drastically simplifies. Okay, so doing that, taking into account the modular weight of this eta function, we get this result. Small, so which is the regime of interest, okay, why not small? This is just approximated by its first term, because if you expand this thing, it's an expansion in exponentials. And so this gives you why not E1 over why not B plus 2 minus y2 squared. That's our generating function in a small y naught approximation. How do we get actual degeneracies out of that? Well, just by Fourier transforming this thing, just like we did before. Simplicity, although by no means essential, we take Q2 equals to zero. So just like last time, this is just y naught, y2, e to the y naught, q naught, dot generating function, okay, in the regime Q not to infinity, which...
Sorry?
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Right, so the large Q naught regime in the saddle point approximation, as you can see, will force this thing to go to small Y naught at the saddle point. If you don't believe it, you can check it for yourself. So this is exactly the approximation we have here. In that case, you get a very simple saddle point computation of this thing. And the result you get is the leading order e to the, and now I'm reinstating all of the correct factors of pi and such. So what I'm using here as well again is the exact expression for b. So I'm using here the fact that b is b cubed. This is for the quintic, plus 50p minus 2. So b plus 2 is exactly 5t cubed plus 50p. Of course, this will be different for different Calabi-Yau manifolds, but again, for completeness, that's what it is. And then this thing divided by 24. Okay, so this is what comes out, and this is indeed exactly the D40 black hole entropy. If you compute it, you know, on the type 2a side, you look at the bulk gravity theory, you know, you put some object with this given D0 rate charge Q naught and P. At the center, you look for supersymmetric black hole solutions, you know, write them down, you read off what the horizon area is, take that thing, divide by 4 times the Newton constant, you find exactly this thing. In fact, this thing does even better. This way of writing things is generating function also gives sub-leading corrections, right, to the leading saddle point approximation, which exactly corresponds to what was conjectured by Noguri, Strominger, and Waffa some years ago. So this is a OSV conjecture, which was famous at some time, maybe not anymore. But so this is exactly what they proposed. Okay, and so you see that. From these vacuum accounting techniques, you precisely get the right result. Okay? So this is one of string theory's claim to glory and fame. Of course, you can get this in various other ways. This is one of them. Right. Okay. Any questions? Clear enough? Okay, so, well, then the technical computational part is kind of over. So let me give some comments. This computation, you know, throughout, we always made a large Q-naught approximation, right? Like, what to extract is leading degeneracy, but also along the way to justify the continuum approximation for the fluxes, right? Like, we ignored quantization and so on. Now, when Q-naught gets... of the order of p cubed or less, okay, stuff gets much more complicated. So the quantization of fluxes becomes important. You also get like important contributions to the entropy from you know, configurations of fluxes that do not completely stable, that do not completely fix the D4 moduli. You get, you know, just very complicated components in this full D40 moduli space. So the system becomes very you know, complicated anyways. Also on the black hole side, all kinds of really interesting things start happening. So in the largest zero brain charge regime, there's just a single black hole solution with those charges, a single centered black hole solution. Now if you lower the zero brain charge at some point, you start getting multi-centered black hole bound states. Okay. Which in fact start dominating the entropy, which start having higher entropy than the single centered black hole for the zero brain charge sufficiently And so this is, clearly somewhat reminiscent. So instead of just having a single thermodynamic equilibrium state, now you have a system which is gravitational dual to like many different thermodynamic equilibrium states, if you think of black holes as equilibrium states. Okay. So clearly this is reminiscent of the spin glass phase transition, where you know below a certain temperature, you suddenly get like an infinite number of thermodynamic equilibrium states. Okay. So it is tempting to conjecture that over here we basically have you know this microscopic D4D0 brain system with like you know many different fluxes interacting, you know, like quantized fluxes interacting with each other quadratically, but with interactions which are highly complex and you know not nearest neighbor or anything, which is long range if you want. That this system is like a spin glass, and that you know even at zero temperature for a certain value of the zero brain charge undergoes a spin glass phase transition, where the you know the multiplicity of thermodynamic states somehow corresponds to these multi-sided black hole black states. But this is let's say speculative conjecture. Okay. Very good. Okay, so I gave this computation in the context of you know localized brains because it has these nice applications to black hole counting. But exactly the same techniques can be applied to space filling brains. Only now you have you know charges which are basically fixed by tadpole cancellation constraints. You can also apply exactly the same kind of techniques to counting bulk flux vacua. Once you get by turning on bulk fluxes, either in type 2B or in M theory or F theory if you want. And so basically, yeah, precisely the same techniques in holding in gravitational landscapes. Okay. Of course, you know, one thing to keep in mind is what these things do is like they don't compute like probability distributions, right? They compute number distributions. Now number distributions can be very useful. As well, if you want to figure out if your theory or a particular class of models that you have has certain properties x and y, okay, which are given by some low energy parameters. So what you do to figure this out is you compute the distribution over xy space, whatever, cosmological constant space, for example, just using these statistical methods. And then if you see that your estimates tell you that you expect a large number, at least larger than one number of vacua, in you know, satisfying these requirements, then you know that this class of models has vacua in it that satisfy what you want, even without you having to actually construct it. Okay, so it's a tremendous simplification of your life. You can go off and do other things. So let me just sum up a couple of the distributions that have been, a few of the results that have been obtained in this way. Some distributions that have been obtained. Some of them. So one is, distributions over moduli space, at least over the part of moduli space where the moduli get fixed by fluxes. Universally, what we find is that you know this that is proportional to the Euler density of the moduli space, where the Euler density is computed with respect to the bundle or the covariant derivative that is of relevance in your theory. So in these D-brain theories,
where you have rigid supersymmetry, you just have the order characteristic of the tangent bundle, right, with respect to the ordinary covariant derivative. In the context of gravity, the relevant covariant derivative that appears in the superpotential and so on is the Kähler covariant derivative, which is the ordinary covariant derivative, plus the Kähler potential term. Okay, and so the relevant order density there is the order density of that bundle, which means you have, well, basically you just get the curvature form plus the Kähler form instead of just the curvature. It's the, okay, so it's proportional to the order density times basically a number which is the volume of a sphere to dimension equal to the number of fluxes you turn on and radius squared equal to flux square type induced charge. Okay, so in the in our case, this was the zero bend charge. In type 2b, for example, with Ramon, Ramon, and SNS fluxes, they, when you square them, you get the three bend charge. So that's a universal result. You can also compute distributions of the cosmological constant, either for supersymmetric vacua or even for non-supersymmetric vacua. Okay, extending these techniques to non-supersymmetric plus vacua. And what you get here is basically a confirmation of the assumptions that Weinberg made in his derivative. Oh, yeah. I've got this here. Nice. PhD came. Okay, sorry. So, let's see. Yeah, so the cosmological constant is basically just uniform. Okay. Which means number of vacua, density of vacua, is just proportional to the region of cosmological constant that you're interested in. Okay, so this justifies this idea that, you know, you just have this landscape of vacua, this discretium, as it is sometimes called, with very finite space out of the cosmological constant, uniformly distributed over, well, at least uniform near zero. Okay. And finally, you can also compute distributions of the supersymmetry breaking scale. Which is sort of intuitive. You think, well, you know, there's obviously many more ways of, you know, getting high supersymmetry breaking scale than low supersymmetry breaking scale. Because roughly speaking, you know, like supersymmetry breaking scale would involve something like flux squared, and there's more flux squareds, which are larger than smaller, right? But there's some subtleties in this computation, and so the result we get is somewhat peculiar. We find that the supersymmetry breaking scale for F term Suzy breaking, DF, right, is distributed something like F to the fifth. Yeah, okay. This is some complicated computation that gets various contributions, and in the end, you find that just like F to the fifth. So many vacua that you can sort of start approximating things by, you know, continuum. Yeah, so these are not exact results, right? These are approximations for, in the case you have a lot of stuff. It's like statistical results.
Wait, I want to say, how is this related to the instanton partition?
The instanton partition, what we did for the D4 brain, it's really an approximation. It's the large D0 brain charge approximation for the type to be D3 instanton partition function, if you want. So if you T-dualize along the time circle, that's what this is. But so there, of course, the exact instanton partition function is extremely complicated, and that's exactly this complication I was talking about for large, smaller D0 brain charge. You know, where you basically sort of, if you want a disorder or glassy structure of these brain configurations becomes important.
And, but somehow you will see the modular invariance of n equals 4.
You see the modular invariance of n equals 4. Yeah, I mean, you know, you.
I mean, this D-dual picture that you mentioned.
Yeah, how do you see it? Or
I mean, this calculation is apparently sufficient to give you the move.
Oh, this is not the exact result at all. Right? This is really. So, as it happens, it is, you know, you get something which is basically a modular form. But it's it only gives you the large D0 brain charge regime, basically. So it's so maybe a priori you could have said like, well, but why does that thing have to be exactly modular? So, yeah, I mean you can say more, and there's actually cases where you can compute the exact partition function for low. So for example, for 1 unit of D4 brain charge on the quintic, you can write down the complete exact partition function, and this comes from the fact that when you know that something is modular, the full modular form is just determined by the so-called polar terms, which in this case are the terms which correspond to negative D0 brain charge. Okay. So once you compute those exactly, you can derive the full modular form. And so there's some exact results now. This gets again difficult for large charges, for large D4 brain charges. In fact, one way to do this is, you know, to get this like negative D0 brain charge in degeneracies is precisely by looking at the corresponding, multi-black hole or multi-particle in this case bound states and computing their degeneracies. So this assumes that there is, of course, an underlying assumption, quite a lot of them. So one is that, indeed, you know, the universe is described by, type 2B string theory on Calabi-Yau interval. We don't know if that's true. And although actually the computation is sort of so generic that it probably holds for any theory which has an n equals 1 topogravity description. And it also assumes that supersymmetry is broken, you know, that basically you have like some F term supersymmetry. So this is a question that Michael Dynes thought about a lot, you know, like what is sort of the dominant supersymmetry breaking mechanism in the landscape, and what can we expect of the supersymmetry breaking scale? And it's of course hard to be definite about it, but sort of the general evidence, indeed, to take his idea seriously, is that we won't see supersymmetry at the LHC. Okay, it's just fine tuned. And conversely, if you see supersymmetry at the LHC, well, maybe you could take this as some evidence against this this single-minded picture. But,
did that calculation include gravitational effects?
Which one? Yeah. It's really in fully gravitational theory. So. Right. Yeah. Okay. Now. But still, nevertheless, all these computations are done sort of in, like, the well-controlled, safe corners of the landscape, where you have Calabi-Yau's and supersymmetry and stuff like that, which, clearly has more to do with our ability to, compute stuff rather than, whatever got squeezed out of the Big Bang or whatever. Right? So, so it's sort of important to try to generalize all these considerations as much as possible, and to describe the landscape in as general as possible terms. And clearly, a first step towards that is is just to look at least the landscape of all possible supergravity compactifications, right? Or any kind of manifold, not necessarily Calabi-Yau, but just like whatever, like with any kind of fluxes and so on. So this is. Basically, part three of this lecture series, if you want. So, this is gravitational landscapes. And, well, originally, I had the ambition to talk about F theory and talk about all these things, but obviously, this is not going to happen. So, let me just talk about these attempts that people have done at describing landscapes as generally as possible. So this is basically the focus of work of Mike Douglas over the past few years. Is the idea, like the question, well, is there such a thing as an effective potential on the landscape of, internal, like the landscape of compactifications? Okay. That is actually a very non-trivial question. First of all, so let's say we start with some general d-dimensional theory, an action, which is of the form, Einstein-Hilbert in d-dimensions, and then some sum of fluxes, B-form fields, squared, a very general action. The most general compactification of such a theory to four dimensions, let's say, for concreteness. Okay, so the most general type of compactification. Okay, again, topologically we think of a d-dimensional space as a product of four-dimensional space and a k-dimensional space. Okay. This product can be warped, meaning metric is of the form e to the 2 of equals psi squared. This is the warp factor. Then some four-dimensional metric, which is maximally symmetric, so it's like ADS, Minkowski, or DS for the vacuum state. And over here, we can just have the internal metric. Okay, so psi is a warp factor. which can depend on the internal space. Yeah. Okay. So now we want to imagine the internal space, you know, which the metric of the internal space, as just some object which is parameterized by an infinite number of parameters, right? The local degrees of freedom, we can parameterize this maybe by its Fourier modes or whatever. So you think of this metric over here as parameterized by some phi A, where A goes from 1 to infinity, okay? Just all possible modes, which means zero modes, but also at all KK modes. Okay, so far the analysis that I showed you, for example, is just restricted to the zero modes. Okay, which you know you can, in some cases, justify, but by far not always. Right, so in order to justify that, you need really a hierarchy of scales that allows you to just forget about your KK modes. In general, you cannot do that, and so you would really have to look at the full thing. And the question is now, can you write down an effective potential for this full thing to begin with? I mean, clearly that's the first step. The effective potential of which, you know, vacua are like minima or critical points. Okay. So we want basically to reduce this thing to four-dimensional action, which is of the form the four-dimensional metric. Four-dimensional Einstein-Hilbert term, then there's some general kinetic terms for these fields, right, which you get by reducing the Einstein-Hilbert action in the high-dimensional space, which is something which in general will look like G A B, depending on phi A, phi B. Right. But then, well, the main thing of interest to us. Now, naively, let's first ignore the warp factor. Naively, you would think, naively effective, naive, normal warp. Okay. So you would say, well, okay, it's just read it off from the action, right? It's just this high-dimensional action, and just the internal part of this should be the effective potential. So you think, okay, even the effective should be the integral over mk, square root of g, k, rk, and then this squared, minus rk, right? Right, where, you know, this g of k and r of k and squared, they all depend on these parameters phi through the internal metric. But, you know, you say, oh, this is just the offshore potential. Now, this obviously is completely, problematic, because it's unbounded from below in a very awful way. Okay? Basically, just by changing the conformal factor of the metric, okay, you can make this thing as negative as you want, and the reason is simply right. So if you write the internal metric GMMK as some e to the 2b g tilde. And you plug this into the formula for the Ricci curvature, then you get something like minus rk, this integral over here, integral minus square root g rk is g tilde part. And then, you know, looking up the relevant formula, you get sufficient square root of see, this thing here is negative, and by just making B fluctuate very rapidly, you can make this thing very, very negative. Okay? So if this is really the effective potential, you would expect that there is a massive instability towards, you know, you start with some smooth manifold to sort of start looking wobbly like that. But even more wobbly, till you know, the whole thing just doesn't look like a manifold at all anymore. The whole thing just crumples up. That would seem to minimize the potential, just gonna run away in that direction. Okay. So this cannot possibly be really, you know, the good notion of effective potential. Now, what gets around this, sort of, you know, why isn't this, you know, why is this correct, is there's two things. So one is the dynamics of the Wahr effector, which we'll see in a moment, is actually sort of tries to cancel this runaway. And then the second is, of course, in gravity, there's like a bunch of constraints, okay, that need to be satisfied. So you cannot just like vary stuff in any way you want. And, well, actually, these kind of problems are somewhat similar to the kind of problems that mathematicians encountered in trying to prove the Tanqueray conjecture, which was then resolved by Perelman, as you all know, and basically inspired by his ideas. Mike Douglas came up with very efficient parametrization and effective potential that resolves all of these issues. Okay. And this was actually also in a slightly less convenient parametrization figured out by Giddings and Majorana. But so the upshot of is what is the real, you know, not the effective naive no Wahr, but the full V effective, including the Wahr factor that you can take as a starting point. It's a result. Okay, so first of all, you get, okay, let me just write down the results. Okay, so psi is a Wahr factor, remember. Now that the gravity constraints are effectively implemented by this potential by requiring stationarity of this potential with respect to psi and the constant c. Okay. So constraint you sort of have to pose in here is dv d psi equals 0 and dv dc equals 0. So this is, the constraint is just what you get from, so, okay, so gravity is a gauge theory, right? So not all components of the metric are really physical degrees of freedom, and basically, just like in, you know, block So basically, you get constraints from varying the degrees of freedom, which, you know, once you fix a gauge, right, like for example, in electromagnetism, it's similar to electromagnetism, once you fix like the A naught equals zero gauge, you still have to impose the equations of motion for A naught, which gives you the Gauss constraint, right? So similarly here, right? And so, these things are there. Now, the question is sort of how can you efficiently encode that in the potential, and this involves some guesswork, but the upshot then of the guesswork was this thing, basically. Mainly this addition. Okay. So these, what do these equations give you? Okay, dv, d psi equals zero gives you an equation, and it's kind of cute. Right, so I just read this off. It's something that's almost the Schrodinger equation. Okay, so it's an inhomogeneous Schrodinger equation. C constraint, sorry, the variation with respect to C, that just tells you that that just normalizes these fields. Okay, so when you look at this equation, you see that the normalization of psi and C is not fixed, but it actually gets fixed just from the requirement that the warped volume is, when you insert a fundamental scale, the higher dimensional Planck mass is 1, the warped volume is nothing but 1 over the Newton constant, right? The usual thing. So no mystery there.
So this is the GK, right?
Yeah, this is the GK, yeah. Okay, and so what's the idea now? How does this like crumpling instability get cured? This is kind of neat. So this psi, remember, is a warp factor, right? So it cannot become zero anywhere.
Okay.
And so if this was really a Schrodinger equation, you have to find a solution to the Schrodinger equation which has no nodes, right? So it's the ground state of the Schrodinger equation. So you can argue that that is, in many cases, a pretty good approximation, that you can really think of the solution of this equation, to some extent, as behaving very much like ground states of the Schrodinger equation. And then you see, when you start crumpling the manifold, if you try, you know, to sort of get these fluctuations in the metric, so what happens, you see this thing over here becomes very negative. Yeah. So that means that this effective Schrodinger potential over here, minus U, becomes very positive. Okay. And so this is as if, you know, you have like a particle in a potential well. The region where the potential well becomes, you know, where the potential becomes very high, the wave function will be exponentially suppressed. Okay. And because of this exponential suppression, also this term in potential here will be exponentially suppressed. So you get sort of a self-correcting behavior, the warp factor, you know, wherever there's like sort of this perverted negative energy density that appears, it completely dumps it away, it warps it away, till you get just no contribution at all. Okay, and so that's sort of what kills off this instability. Okay, so that's the picture. There's some arguments in favor of it, but it's actually still conjectural. So nobody has proven this. Conceivably, it can be proved sort of like along the lines of like a positive energy theorem or something like that, but this is an open,
So this constraint, can you just interpret it as saying this is that you need Einstein's equation to be satisfied on a compact space?
Yeah. The last one?
Or maybe the combination of the two, somehow. I'm not sure exactly.
So you still have to vary with respect to the internal metric components, which will be Einstein equation on the compact space. So that's of course the true set of equations of motion.
Oh, yeah.
What this tells you, so C is really a constant, so this is just a single integral, and it just tells you what you already know, that you know, if you complexify your theory, then the lower dimensional Planck mass is given by the volume times the higher dimensional one.
Could
be
perfect pi. Didn't the string come from the diagonal components of the equation?
Yeah, so there's a G one naught and a G zero I, right? That is the shift in the lab. Yeah. But the claim is that that you know, for vacuum compactifications, okay, that this is sufficient. You don't need to. So you're using also this sort of the symmetry of the solution, and this is enough. So you don't have to impose like more constraints. They're all implied by this. That's sort of the simplification. Of course, this will not give you all solutions to Einstein's equations in the dimensions. This gives you the vacuum solutions basically.
So it's not sufficient to consider this as just the constraint side of the Einstein equation. He seems to be saying there's more than that.
No. So this is if you're interested in solutions which are of that form, this warped form, right, with the four-dimensional metric maximally symmetric, then this is sufficient. That's what I'm saying. Okay. So this is the first step. Now, once you have this, you can, this hasn't been done yet, but you can start thinking about things like, oh, well, now I have this infinite dimensional configuration space with a potential. Can I think about like a slow roll inflation in there, for example, right? The usual wave, phi dot is minus 1 over h v prime, right? But now in this infinite dimensional configuration space. And in fact, those equations look a lot like the Ricci flow equations that was considered. Modified Ricci flow equations considered by Perelman, and so you get some sort of an intriguing possible relation between slow roll inflation in these spaces of metrics and Ricci flow. But all of that isn't being worked out. So it's okay. So in the last 7 minutes, you know. Given all this work that has been done on the landscape and so on, what do we know about its size? You know, how big is it? And, well, one zero-order question is, you could ask, is it finite? Is there a finite number of string back? And of course, obviously, the question is no. Because, for example, if you look at ADS5 times S5 with some flux quantum number, with flux number n, then you already get an infinite number of vacua for which we even have an exact non-perturbative description in the forms of n equals 4 SUN Young-Mills theory. Okay, so clearly, the landscape of string theory vacua defined in this sense is infinite. However, obviously, those vacua are, you know, in no way connected to our own, or look like our own. So the more relevant question to ask is, once you impose some cut on the size of the internal manifold, right, is it finite then? So for this ADS5 times S5 vacua, when n goes to infinity, the size of the S5 goes to infinity, which means that if you want the lower dimensional Newton constant in fixed fundamental units runs off to zero. So if you say, well, I put a cutoff there, is the number finite or not? Once you impose this cutoff, like, you know, it's basically a bound, well, you can think of it as a bound on the diameter, or this, you know, this size, radius of the internal manifold, or equivalently, a lower bound on the lowest KK mass excitation, the lower bound on the mass of the lowest KK excitation, then first of all results which are known, you know, from statistics and number estimates and so on, remarkably indicate that this number seems to be finite. Okay, this didn't have to be the case. You know, looking at all this computation that we did, for example, you know, none of the constraints show manifestly that this number should be finite, but nevertheless, it turns out to be the case. In fact, you can even often use this as some way of detecting that particular proposed constructions in the literature of vacua are wrong. If you find you can get like an infinite number that stay within like cuts on parameter space, the construction no doubt is wrong. So that's remarkable. There's another remarkable mathematical theorem, and it's the so-called Cheeger's finiteness theorem, which says that if you normalize the volume of some manifold equal to 1, which is unit such that the volume is 1, so this is, okay, let me call this, give this thing a name, it's Cheeger's theorem, it's a mathematical theorem, and basically what it says is working units with volume equal to 1, then, one, if all components of the Riemann curvature in an orthonormal frame, right, are less than some fixed value, K star, the mathematicians like to phrase in terms of the sectional curvature, but this is basically what it means. You put a bound, an upper bound on the curvature, which for physical reasons obviously makes sense because we don't trust classical approximation when this gets too large, one, and two, and this is this cut I was talking about, like you want the KK masses to stay above a certain level. So the mathematical precise statement of this is a diameter d stays less than a certain number. So what is the diameter? The diameter is the maximal distance between any pair of 2 points inside of the manifold.
Do you mean R, contracted with R in square root, or?
No, so you go to an orthonormal frame,
okay.
Right, then the square root of G is 1, right? And then this is the, yeah. So you could say that, okay, well, you could say the sectional curvature, so it's okay, stop. Then, remarkably, there's only a finite number of topologies that satisfy that. There's only a finite number of, in fact, even diffeomorphism types that satisfy this. Okay. There's a bound on the number of manifolds that exist that satisfy this thing. And the intuition is basically, you know, if you want to go to like more and more topologies, keeping the volume fixed and the diameter, you know, bounded, you know, you have to sort of put more and more and more handles, but you see that will tend to increase the curvature, and at some point you can't do this anymore.
So is that diffeomorphism or absolute?
Is this what? Up to?
Diffeomorphism.
Yeah, up to diffeomorphism, of course, yeah, because there's always, well, there's infinitely many diffeomorphisms, so these diffeomorphism classes,
What?
Oh. Any dimension. This is in any dimension. Yeah.
You mean
you fix the dimension norm.
There's even a finite number of differentiable structures?
Yeah. That's right. For a compact manifold, so fixed volume and bound curvatures. At least I think that's diffeomorphism types mean. To the extent that that's what diffeomorphism types means, the answer is yes. Yeah. Okay. Well, so this brings me at the end. So I had wanted to say some things about, you know, okay, so say, so, okay, so given this theorem, it's reasonable to conjecture that actually within this, you know, putting these cuts, the landscape of string vacua is finite. Okay, all evidence seems to point in favor of that, which is truly remarkable, and there must be some reason for it, right? Which, you know, which we don't know at this point. But this again points to the fact that, you know, there should be some structures existing in the landscape, constraining the landscape, that at this point we don't know, but, you know, that have this highly non-trivial consequences, such as finiteness. Okay. So, right, that's an interesting question to ponder. Now, even even if you have a finite number, you know, this number is obviously still going to be very large, and so you run into questions of, like, well, tractability, computational complexity, and computability, and, well, I wanted to say some things about that, but I will not be able to, but let me give you three references in case if you're interested in such issues, and I'll just end. You can, okay, so this is complexity. One is sort of it's basically a large review of complexity theory plus some one particular result showing that the problem of finding, as I already mentioned, the problem of finding vacua with small cosmological constant in the Gustav-Polchinski landscape is an antimodal problem. Okay, so this is a paper of myself and Mike Douglas. Exact reference, but the title is Computational Complexity of the Landscape. Okay, if you search for this, you'll find it. So that's sort of a general review of these results. Then there's a very nice paper by a computational complexity theorist. Okay, this obviously has nothing to do with the string theory landscape. Scott Aronson, he's at MIT now. And that paper, it's called NP-complete problems. Problems and physical reality. Okay, this is an absolutely awesome paper, very entertaining to read, where he explores basically the relation between, you know, well, basically the fact that NP-complete problems are intractable for computers, right? But also apparently for nature. And it turns out that if you change the laws of physics as we know them at any place, you can actually cook up like an imaginary computer, natural computer, that solves NP-complete problems in polynomial time. So one of the things he notes, for example, is if you change the laws of quantum mechanics, instead of, like, you know, psi squared probabilities, for example, you take psi cube probabilities, or you change unitarity, or you change linearity of quantum mechanics, any of these things, it makes it trivial to build a quantum computer that can solve NP-complete problems in polynomial time. But this is not the case. So it seems that there's sort of weird relation between the laws of physics, as we know them, and the fact that things that are hard not just for ourselves, but for nature too. Okay, and so he works out several examples, and, you know, I can highly recommend this to have a look at. And then finally, sorry for going a little bit over time, this is the very last thing I'm saying. There's a series of remarkable papers by mathematicians, Navitovsky in particular, and Weinberger. You can go to the website. Navitovsky has all his papers there, but one which is maybe in particular relevant is called The Fractal Nature of, okay, now you see it's a mathematician, Riem, Diff, and then one. I think the one refers to, it's supposed to be the first paper in a series of two That's usually the second one didn't come, but so the fractal nature of Riemann difference. So in that mode, so what these guys have been doing is sort of use theorems out of like undecidability theorems, basically, to prove geometrical statements about metrics. So one of the things they use is, so it's well, from the undecidability of the so-called word problem, you can deduce that it's impossible, that is, you know, not just like hard, but impossible to write down an algorithm that recognizes the topology of a manifold of dimension greater than 4. Okay, so you give, you have some triangulation or something, you would think, well, there should be some machine which you can feed this thing, and then it tells you what kind of topology this is, or recognizes what manifold this is, or more concretely, if you have like two of these triangulations that figures out if they are topologically equivalent, so you can show that it's impossible to have a computer like that. Okay. And usually the way these things go is like, okay, so you imagine that you have a computer that does this, then you turn this computer into a topology, you sabotage the topology a little, and then you show that it's impossible that this computer can recognize itself, or something like that, right? So that's how these things usually go, so they're kind of recursive. But just from that, he manages to show that for a wide class of functionals on the space of metrics, you necessarily have a landscape with infinitely many minima, infinitely high barriers, and the reason basically is like, if you have a sufficiently good functional that sort of is some sort of a measure for the complexity of the manifold, so something proportional to the, curvature, sectional curvature squared times diameter, sectional curvature times diameter squared, or something like that, some scaling variant functional. If that thing had like a unique minimum or like a finite number of them, you could just use it to build an algorithm that recognizes topologies. Basically, you take your triangulation, you feed it to this machine that just like applies gradient flow for this functional to the metric that you feed it, arriving at some standard metric, which is unique if it's a unique one, which is unique if you have a unique minimum or just finite number, dependent number, and this would give you an algorithm that that recognizes topology. Since it's proven that it's impossible, it must mean that the landscape defined by such a functional necessarily has like infinitely many minima, infinitely deep, so that basically you cannot use this idea to recognize the topology. Okay, so it's like this twisted kind of reasoning that allows you to prove statements in geometry about numbers of solutions to equations of motion derived from certain functionals. Okay, so so that shows that. Even if we will never be able to describe the landscape as a whole, we might be able to say a lot about it. There's a reason it's like that. Okay, I went brutally over time, so we'll stop here, and I hope you enjoyed these lectures. I survived, I'm happy.